watching Bloomberg UTV.
It's one of the most successful banks globally, and its head, Jamie Dimon, is considered a legend in the banking circles because JP Morgan Chase was one of the few banks left standing after the subprime crisis. But what is JP Morgan's India plans, and what's the mandate the person at the helm here, Kalpana Morparia, has? To understand this, I caught up with Kalpana, who took charge of the bank's Indian operations after spending 33 long years at ICICI Bank. When most others would have been happy retiring and enjoying life after a long and fruitful innings, Kalpana decided to take on a new challenge. But before I asked her about her plans for JP Morgan, I began by asking what she was picking up from her institutional clients and whether they were betting big on the India growth story.
I think it's really very strong, and I've continuously said that India is very unique in having such a strong investment pipeline, and the numbers speak for themselves, really driven a lot by domestic consumption. So we are fortunate to be having these two twin powers of sectors of growth, as it were. And I think India is reaping the full benefit of that.
There is a view somewhere down the line, largely coming out of Dalal Street in the markets, that we might have peaked out, you know, in terms of earnings, in times of, especially if you're looking at an interest rate cycle, which is going to go only up from here. Do you share that view, or do you think there is room there?
See, whenever you look at valuations, there are two things there is. One is the earnings power. So what are your EBITDA margins, and, you know, what are your PBT and PAT margins? And the other is, what is your growth? And growth for India, given that we've now started talking about how can we sustain double-digit growth numbers rather than having this debate of 8 or 9%. So given that growth projection, and equity and Dalal Street or whatever it is really all about the growth, you know, it's about the future. That's how equity valuations take place. I think India stacks up pretty well.
To be fair, the government has done well to build on the buzz around India and the opportunity for growth. It has announced a massive $1 trillion project to build Indian infrastructure, which, if it comes through, could be a game changer. The big plans from the government are around that $1 trillion package for infrastructure, etc. Do you buy into that? Because execution has always been a problem. And when you meet foreign investors, for instance, what do they tell you? I mean, are they bullish about the India story right now?
So everyone knows that India has to invest in infrastructure, whether they visit India or not. I mean, this is so evident. And rather than saying $1 trillion and all of that, I'd much prefer to say it. What are all the projects that have been awarded? Where are the bottlenecks in terms of financing? And indeed, there is a challenge in getting access to fixed rate, long-term money. So the recent initiative which is being talked about, you know, the Deepak Parekh committee talking about creating an infrastructure fund, although small, relatively small in terms of $10, $11 billion, I think will be great if we can get it off the ground, because it can act as a prototype for other initiatives that might come from the private sector. So certainly there is a policy will to do things for infrastructure. There is a lot of private sector interest and enterprise waiting for that to happen. And I'm sure if we can fix some of these unique challenges in terms of execution, it's a great story waiting to unfold.
The Deepak Parekh-headed expert group has recommended that private companies should manage the proposed infrastructure fund with an initial capital of 50,000 crore rupees for financing projects in this crucial sector. It is proposed by the group that the fund should be given income tax rebates on the line of venture capital funds. The group also recommends that flexibility should be given to the fund to tap external commercial borrowings. For this, certain rules have to be tweaked in the Income Tax Act and the RBI rules. But can this huge amount be raised without a good debt market? Because the biggest problem infrastructure companies have is the fact that they don't have access to long-term debt. Can it happen without a debt market and a robust debt market?
So if you really analyze as to why India does not have a robust debt market, the prime reason is lack of long-term investors in domestic debt. We cap the amount that foreign investors can put into India. And the domestic institutional investors have typically invested in government bonds, as you know, other than insurance sector and mutual funds. And mutual funds, by no stretch of imagination, can be really called long-term. Insurance, there has been a much greater flow into equities. So a dedicated effort like creating that infrastructure bond, which says that we are addressing all the issues surrounding the construction risk in a project, and really giving an opportunity to long-term investors, both domestic and foreign, to invest in stable cash flows that will be coming out of an operating asset. And the government through any agency will also step in and provide a subordinated piece to give greater comfort on the various cash flows, you know, the waterfall mechanism. I think it's a good initiative to do that. And once that starts, very naturally, you will have an impetus towards people participating in a long-term debt market.
Right. The other big initiative is, of course, the free float aspect of increasing free float to 25%. As someone who's seen the markets, you know, mature, what impact do you think this will have? Will it go through the way it is being proposed, or do you think it has to be a watered-down version?
So I think in itself, when they announced the policy, they said that, you know, if the market cap is beyond a particular amount, you can have an increase of 5%. So that itself will give a 3 or 4 year window within which to reach it. And if you look at the absolute numbers and exercise was done, did what this entail, I think the total amount at a particular time of market cap came to something like $32 billion, of which $26 billion is just PSUs. So if you look at the private sector, I don't think that's a big amount. That's $4 or $5 billion. And MNCs, in fact, where much is being talked about and debated, is just about some $600 or $700 million. So it's not as though it's really going to be difficult in the context of MNCs either electing to delist or just raising that amount, or indeed for the private sector. Some clarity is required whether you can do this through a QIP. Currently, QIPs, as you know, are allowed only for primary issuances and not for an offer for sale. How will you treat GDRs and ADRs? Currently, they are excluded, but I'm sure there's some debate and discussion around that. And the PSUs, I'm sure, will have to be a much more calibrated approach towards eventually getting to that 25%.
Up next, JP Morgan's big plans in India and why it doesn't want to go in for a retail play here.